Calling ceasefire in Syria.
Also ahead this Tuesday, the CEO of Wells Fargo apologizes for millions of fraudulent accounts, but says the practice was not a scheme.
We never directed nor wanted our team members to provide products and services to customers that they did not want.
And exploring the presidential candidate's plans on education, we continue our series looking at the issues shaping the election.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
XQ Institute.
SF Railway. Lincoln Financial, committed to helping you take charge of your financial future. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
For the president today, a moment on the world stage at the United Nations one last time. His message, no less than an urgent plea to make a better world.
At this moment, we all face a choice.
It was his final address to the UN General Assembly, and President Obama used it to issue a challenge.
We can choose to press forward with a better model of cooperation and integration, or we can retreat into a world sharply divided and ultimately in conflict along age-old lines of nation and tribe and race and religion.
The president spoke of a growing contest between authoritarian rule and liberalism, and of people losing faith in the face of terrorism and the refugee crisis.
Given the difficulty in forging true democracy in the face of these pressures, it's no surprise that some argue the future favors the strong man, a top-down model, rather than strong democratic institutions. But I believe this thinking is wrong. I believe the road of true democracy remains the better path.
Mr. Obama appealed to the world to do more for the millions fleeing war-torn countries. And he warned against the politics of Donald Trump without mentioning the Republican nominee by name.
And the world is too small for us to simply be able to build a wall and prevent it from affecting our own societies.
The Prime Minister of the United Kingdom.
Newly named British Prime Minister Theresa May making her first address at the UN after her country's vote to leave the European Union said Brexit was not a signal that Britain was retreating from its global responsibilities.
They did not vote to turn inwards or walk away from any of our partners in the world. Faced with challenges like migration, they demanded a politics that is more in touch with their concerns and bold action to address them. But that action must be more global, not less.
But for many leaders, Syria topped the agenda. President Obama aimed strong criticism at the Syrians' main ally, Russia, for its aggressive moves there and in Ukraine.
In a world that left the age of empire behind, we see Russia attempting to recover lost glory through force. It may fuel nationalist fervor for a time, but over time it is also going to diminish its stature and make its borders less secure.
UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon also forcefully denounced the Syrian regime and its main backer in his last address to the General Assembly.
There is no military solution. Many groups have killed many innocents, none more so than the government of Syria, which continues to bomb neighborhoods and systematically torture thousands of detainees. Powerful patrons also have blood on their hands.
François Hollande.
French President François Hollande added his own demand to stop the killing in Syria.
Cette tragédie syrienne sera devant l'histoire.
The Syrian tragedy will be seen by history as a disgrace for the international community if we do not end it quickly. Thousands of children have died in bombings. Whole populations are starving. Humanitarian convoys are being attacked. Chemical weapons are being used.
Turkey's President Recep Tayyip Erdogan joined those who call for a solution in Syria, but his main focus was an exile cleric in the U.S., Fethullah Gulen, whom Erdogan and his government accuse of fomenting the failed July coup.
Kendi güvenlikleri için, ülkelerinin geleceği için.
I am calling from this podium to all of our friends to swiftly take the necessary measures against the Gulenist terrorist organization for their own safety and the future of their nations.
The General Assembly continues through next Monday.
In the day's other news, new details emerged on Ahmad Khan Rahami, the suspect in the New York and New Jersey bombings. The New York Times reported the FBI briefly investigated Rahami in 2014 after he allegedly stabbed his brother. At the time, his father told police that Rahami was a, quote, terrorist, but he later recanted and an investigation found nothing.
Authorities in France have made 8 new arrests in a deadly truck attack in July. 86 people were killed when a driver plowed through crowds of revelers in the Mediterranean city of Nice on Bastille Day, the French national holiday. The attacker, a Tunisian, was killed by police. The suspects arrested on Monday are French and Tunisian.
The United Nations has suspended all aid deliveries to Syria after an attack on a Red Crescent convoy killed at least 20 people. It happened near the northern city of Aleppo just hours after a ceasefire expired. Footage today showed the charred wreckage of trucks lining the streets and supplies, some marked with the UN logo, strewn about.
This very, very dark day for humanitarians in Syria, and I'd say across the world, because I think there's been a moment of shock and, frankly, disgust by this attack.
Russia denied claims that its warplanes attacked the convoy, but it did say there is drone footage showing heavily armed militants traveling with the aid trucks.
A fire roared through a migrant camp on the Greek island of Lesbos overnight. Thousands fled and no one was injured, but 60% of the camp was destroyed. The fire broke out late Monday and was extinguished by midday today. The camp houses several thousand migrants. Police say the fire started after clashes between different ethnic groups.
Back in this country, Hillary Clinton took a day off the trail to study up for next week's first presidential debate, while Donald Trump went back to school. John Yang has our report.
Donald Trump went to college today, courting the millennial vote. At High Point University in North Carolina, he appeared to lecture Hillary Clinton about fighting terrorism.
Her claim that my opposition to radical Islamic terrorism is a recruiting tool, but why? Because I'm tough? It's a recruiting tool? It demonstrates a level of ignorance about the terror threat.
It came amid more questions about the charitable Trump Foundation. The Washington Post reported it paid more than $250,000 to settle lawsuits involving his businesses. The Trump campaign didn't respond. And social media became a battleground over Donald Trump Jr.'s tweet likening Syrian refugees to a tainted bowl of Skittles. A Clinton campaign spokesman called it disgusting. And a former Obama speechwriter tweeted a picture that had earlier gone viral, saying this Syrian boy is one of the millions of children you compared to a poison Skittle. Clinton made no public appearances today, but there was word she may get the vote of a former Republican president. Politico reported that former Maryland Lieutenant Governor Kathleen Kennedy Townsend, daughter of the late Robert Kennedy, posted on Facebook that George H.W. Bush had told her he's voting for Hillary. Today, a Bush spokesman said the former president is a private citizen and his vote will be, too, private. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm John Yang.
Relief is on the way for five southern states after a gasoline pipeline leak in Alabama. Colonial Pipeline said today that it has completed a bypass line and can restart the flow tomorrow. The leak has caused many gas stations in the region to shut down pumps, and prices have jumped more than 20 cents in some parts.
21 states went to federal court today to block a new overtime pay rule. It takes effect December 1st and requires overtime for salaried workers making less than $47,500. That's double the current threshold. The states say it places a heavy new burden on state budgets.
And a slow day on Wall Street. The Dow Jones Industrial Average gained 9 points to close near 18,130. The NASDAQ rose 6, and the S&P 500 added a fraction. Still to come on the NewsHour, new details on abuse at a Marine training camp. Tulsa police promised justice after the death of an unarmed black man. Breaking down the presidential candidate's plans on education and much more.
Lifelong success.
The CEO of Wells Fargo appeared on Capitol Hill and faced a barrage of questions about the bank's conduct under his leadership and why employees opened nearly 2 million phony accounts. Regulators say the workers, under pressure to meet sales goals, had secretly created unauthorized bank and credit card accounts for customers since 2011 without their knowledge. Today, Bank Chairman John Stumpf apologized before the Senate Banking Committee.
I am deeply sorry that we failed to fulfill on our responsibility to our customers, to our team members, and to the American public. We never directed nor wanted our team members to provide products and services to customers that they did not want. That is not good for our customers, and that is not good for our business. It is against everything we stand for as a company.
More than 5,000 workers, mostly lower level, have been fired. But senators on both sides of the aisle said it was Stumpf who should be paying the price. Massachusetts Democrat Elizabeth Warren.
So you haven't resigned. You haven't returned a single nickel of your personal earnings. You haven't fired a single senior executive. Instead, evidently, your definition of accountable is to push the blame to your low-level employees who don't have the money for a fancy PR firm to defend themselves. It's gutless leadership. You squeezed your employees to the breaking point so they would cheat customers and you could drive up the value of your stock and put hundreds of millions of dollars in your own pocket. And when it all blew up, you kept your job, you kept your multi-million dollar bonuses.
We turn now to Michael Corkery, who's been reporting on the story for the New York Times. Michael, you were in the room today, in the hearing chamber today, and you saw the outrage that was expressed by Republicans and Democrats, not just Elizabeth Warren, but also David Vitter. Outrage is easy. What's the fix they're asking for?
Well, I think they want more accountability. I mean, this fraud was extraordinary for how widespread it was. I mean, it affected, thousands of customers. We're talking upwards of 2 million potentially fakely created accounts by Wells Fargo employees, 5,300 bank workers, mostly low-level, low-paid bank workers have been fired. But I think what the committee was focused on, and what Elizabeth Warren in particular was taking up the charge for, was that none of the senior executives seemed to have been affected, either losing their jobs or taking back some of their compensation.
How long have the senior executives known about this problem?
Well, John Stumpf said he first knew about it in 2013, though the problems may have gone back to 2011. But even that, even 2013, this problem has been going on for 3 years in some form or another. Those employees that have been fired over a period of 5 years. And even up to this year, people were being fired at the bank for this behavior, low-level workers. So I think, again, the committee was focused on why didn't you do more sooner to take care of this problem and get rid of it.
Now, some employees said that this problem cropped up because of a culture of competition at Wells Fargo. What are they talking about?
Wells is a very hard-driving bank. It's very successful, very profitable. Stock has been on a tear. What they say is that employees were under these enormous pressure to meet these sales goals, to open as many new accounts as they can. In fact, John Stump wanted all bank customers, one of his goals was to have every bank customer have 8 accounts, 8 products with Wells Fargo. It's an enormous amount of products. I mean, if you think, well, you've got a loan or a checking account, a savings account. And so these employees thought they were unrealistic. They said they were totally unrealistic. And in order to meet them, not just to gain big bonuses, but just to keep their jobs, they felt compelled to meet these. And in order to do that, many of these former employees said they needed to bend the rules. They needed to fake them.
Is there a dollar number you can put on the number of accounts, so the dollar impact on actual account holders who found out that they held a lot more accounts in their name than they realized?
Right now, regulators, particularly the CFPB, started by Elizabeth Warren, has put the number at about 2 million. It's not a big number when you consider the extent of the fraud. And that's what's kind of weird here is that, I mean, yes, these fees meant things to people. These were, you know, these were overdraft fees. These were late fees on credit cards they didn't know they had. But again, it was happening in ways where sometimes a bank employee would open up an account for someone, the person didn't know it, and then 2 days later they would close it. And they would just do it just to get credit for the sale. And it suggests that this selling culture was so broken that it wasn't even making the bank money. It was just meeting goals for the sake of meeting goals.
But some of the sympathy in the hearing room today seemed to be for the employees who were fired, who were, they think, were treated as scapegoats?
Yeah, I mean, I think they kept coming back to this point over and over again. Again, 5,000 employees. I mean, these are people mostly who make about $12 an hour. Those are the ones who've been fired. At this point, other than a few, as John Stump said quite vaguely, managers and managers of managers, nobody in the C-suite, no big top executive, has lost their job. And I think that, you know, that has the optics, at least, of the little guy gets squeezed and gets hurt and takes the fall, and the big CEOs get off.
Michael Corkery of the New York Times, thank you very much.
Thank you.
We turn to the revelations of abuse at the Marine Corps training facility at Parris Island, South Carolina. An internal investigation that began after the death of a young recruit earlier this year has uncovered a larger pattern of hazing and abuse at the legendary facility. The NewsHour's William Brangham, who's recently been reporting at Parris Island, joins me now for more. So, William, tell us about this investigation that's been underway.
As you mentioned, this whole investigation began when this 20-year-old Marine recruit, he was a man named Raheel Siddiqui, he's from Michigan, he jumped off a third-floor balcony and fell to his death. The investigation that went into that death revealed that he had been physically abused by one of his drill instructors. He had, the morning that he died, he went out and claimed that he had a sore throat and asked for a medical to be sent to the doctor. And his drill instructor apparently didn't believe him and made him run laps up and down the barracks where they were sleeping. He then apparently wasn't responding to his drill instructor appropriately, and so he was choked. He fell to the ground, and then his drill instructor apparently got over him and slapped him in the face at least once, perhaps 3 times. In which he jumped up at that point, ran out the back door, and leapt off the balcony and fell to his death. Now, the Marines have ruled this a suicide. His family believes he was targeted specifically and was abused intentionally. Apparently, this drill instructor involved in this had referred to this young man as a terrorist before. The bigger thing that this investigation has revealed is that this particular drill instructor had been investigated prior to this for another instance of abuse on another Muslim recruit a year before, where he had apparently called this young man a terrorist, also had put him into a large commercial dryer, had run that dryer and burned the young recruit.
A clothes dryer.
A clothes dryer, huge, one of these large industrial dryers. And so the family's argument and the Marines say, why was this man reassigned into this case? And so this investigation has just continued to unfold from there.
Now, you you were just at Paris Island reporting on another story just in the last few weeks. Did you see any evidence of this kind of treatment of these recruits?
No, we saw nothing of the kind. Producer Dan Segallen and I were down there. We were reporting a story about how women are now entering more combat roles in the Marine Corps, and we were following some female recruits. And we saw no evidence of anything like this. I mean, we saw what a lot of civilians would look at as almost stereotypical Marine drill sergeant behavior.
I'm mad.
You just got your teeth killed.
It's rough and tough stuff. A drill sergeant's yelling at young recruits, making them run around, sometimes running to the point of exhaustion, a lot of chaos, a lot of screaming. But that's what the Marine Corps thinks of as its honored tradition of turning civilians into corps. And so we saw no evidence of abuse whatsoever, nothing that's alleged in this investigation.
You were telling me that there are still more allegations out there about the way recruits have been treated by these drill instructors.
That's right. This investigation, which hasn't been released to the public, we went to the Pentagon yesterday to read it for a few hours. This investigation revealed at least a dozen other drill instructors were involved in what the Marine Corps calls the fostering of a culture of abuse. So physically hitting recruits, encouraging other recruits to hit other recruits, choking of recruits, a real lack of oversight by officers looking into this. It's blossomed into a much larger investigation in the Corps.
So you mentioned officers. Who is being held accountable for this at this point?
Well, right now, no one has been criminally charged with any wrongdoing whatsoever. Several people have been fired or dismissed. They've let go a colonel, a lieutenant colonel, and a sergeant major. But right now, the Marine Corps is still trying to decide who should be prosecuted, who might face a court-martial, what sort of disciplinary action. But there are at least 20 Marines who are subject to possible further sanction for their actions in these cases.
You and I were also discussing the fact that over years, there have been allegations made about what's been going on at Paris Island. Have they changed their techniques, the MO, the way they operate in general over time?
The Marine Corps would say yes, that they have been very diligent about this. There was a notorious incident back in the 50s where a drill instructor led a group of recruits into a very dangerous circumstance and several died. Reforms were made after that. There were also a series of reforms and training made after the end of the Vietnam era when we moved from a draft to a more volunteer army. With regards to these particular allegations, the biggest concern that we heard in talking to current Marines and former Marines is that the leadership failed in their job here, that this type of abuse should not have been allowed to fester and blossom the way it did. And that's really the most damning part of the investigation, is that the supervisory officers who should have been observing this activity really were absent and negligent to their duties.
It is such a disturbing story, and I know the reporting on it continues, as well as the investigations. William Brangham, thank you.
Thank you.
There are new calls for a federal investigation into the police shooting of an unarmed black man in Tulsa, Oklahoma, raising questions yet again about the relationship between law enforcement and citizens of color. 40-year-old Terrence Crutcher was killed on Friday when local officers responded to a call of a stalled vehicle in the middle of the road. Police video subsequently showed Crutcher, hands in the air, walking away from the officers before police fired. Here is some of that video.
That looks like a bad dude, too, to be honest with you.
I think he may have just been tasered.
Shots fired!
We have shots fired. We have one suspect down. We need him to here.
An attorney for the officer said she believed Crutcher was armed and did not heed instruction. But attorneys for the family say the video proves otherwise. And they believe the officer who shot him, Betty Jo Shelby, should be charged with murder. She is on paid administrative leave. His twin sister, Tiffany, noted that officers watching at a distance from a helicopter could be heard on tape referring to her brother as a bad dude.
That big bad dude was my twin brother. That big bad dude was a father. Mm. That big bad dude was a son. That big bad dude was enrolled at Tulsa Community College. Just wanting to make us proud.
For the latest on the investigation and the mood in the city of Tulsa, I'm joined by Jeannie Graham, columnist for the Tulsa World newspaper. Jeannie Graham, the Washington Post keeps a database now in which they say in the past year, 696 people, 172 of them black men, have been fatally shot by police. In Tulsa, how did this come about?
This particular incident, some of that is unfolding. We know that he had a stalled car and that the officer, Betty Shelby, was responding to a different call and came upon him. The problem is there is some missing video, or not missing video, there was no video leading up to what we now see. And it's pretty clear that he had his hands up, and you can see other officers responded. Then you had the aerial view, and he was shot. He was tasered and then shot. And so people are coming to their own conclusions watching the video, and other people have lingering questions about what led up to that, how he responded, and then how the officers responded directly after that.
Is there,
because he was left on the street.
Yeah, he was left on the street for some time. Is there a distinction or a dispute between what the police account of the incident is and what others are saying?
Not so much right now. The police aren't saying too much. They're launching their own investigation, and they will be returning those results over to the district attorney, who will decide on a charge. But there is also another investigation going on. The police chief had called the Justice Department early on, and the U.S. attorney is looking into this as an independent and parallel investigation to see if there are any federal civil rights violations that occurred. And so he will be releasing those results at the same time.
We got to see this video relatively quickly, more quickly than we often see in these cases. Do you think what happened in Tulsa with the police rapid response, or relatively rapid response, is a result of what we've seen happen in other cities and other places?
It could be. There are also efforts throughout the year to talk about race in Tulsa. We have had a dubious history of dealing with race issues. And so for the last decade or two decades, there have been various groups to try to forge relationships in between these tense times. And so this is going to be a challenge for the city leaders on how they move forward. But I think the other cities and how they've dealt with that are certainly a caution. But there's also a call for transparency to get the information out quickly, put it out to the public, and then we can make decisions from there on what, if they acted correctly.
When you talk about Tulsa's dubious history, you're referring not only to instances where there have been police-involved shootings, but going all the way back to 1921, right?
Exactly. We had an infamous 1921 race riot, and it burned a section of the city to the ground. And it was the part of the city referred to as Black Wall Street. And for decades, that wound was left to fester. That part of town was never rebuilt. The families were never given any sort of help to rebuild. And it was only in the 1990s that a commission was established to investigate what happened during that time. And since then, there is the John Hope Reconciliation Center that holds a national forum on race. There are other groups in the city that hold seminars, symposiums, dialogues, and talks. But all of that is going to be tested right now, as I said, because right now, people are upset, they're grieving, they're angry. And so how the city responds, whether they're going to be straightforward, whether they're going to live up to their promises, that's what's going to determine the relationships from here on out. So hopefully our city has learned some lessons on how to heal, how to deal with this in a peaceful yet justful manner.
Well, and it should be said that right up until now, we haven't seen riots or unrest or fires or looting, have we?
Not in Tulsa. And we've had a couple of incidents before where last year we had our county deputy sheriff, a reserve officer, shot and killed an unarmed black man as well. And our district attorney filed charges, and that ended with a secondary manslaughter conviction. So there is some history that our city leaders will do the right thing. And there have been calls from the family and from other leaders to be patient, but yet, you know, keep up the oversight, because protests are more than welcome. Our police chief even said he invites protesters. They came into the press conference. The hope is that they can remain peaceful and that we can sit down and have this discussion about, you know, how can we be safe on our streets and how can we build trust that people that are living in North Tulsa and all over Tulsa feel safe with the police that are on the streets and find out what happened and to act swiftly.
Jenny Graham, columnist for the Tulsa World, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Stay with us. Coming up on the NewsHour, Ken Burns' newest film about a couple who dared to defy the Nazis and the overlooked challenges of first-generation college students. But first, our coverage of the issues in this presidential campaign continues, and we're taking the opportunity to focus on where they stand on education as part of our weekly series, Making the Grade. Correspondent Lisa Desjardins gets us started with this primer.
It is a wide education gap. The candidates disagree not just on how to fix schools, but also on what the problems are. First, Donald Trump.
That's why I'm proposing a plan to provide school choice to every disadvantaged student in America.
The Republican wants a $12,000 voucher for every child living in poverty.
That means parents will be able to send their kids to the desired public, private, or even religious school of their choice.
Here's Trump's math. $12,000 times 11 million kids, that's over $130 billion. To pay for that, Trump would kick in $20 billion in federal funds, and he'd like states to find the rest, over $100 billion. Libertarian Gary Johnson has long pushed for vouchers, but he is to the right of Trump on something else. He would close the Department of Education and send savings back to the states. Hillary Clinton, on the other hand, strongly opposes vouchers, charging that Trump's plan would gut public school funding. One of her biggest changes would be for even younger kids, a universal preschool plan that was part of her campaign launch last year.
Our country won't be competitive or fair if we don't help more families give their kids the best possible start in life.
Another contrast, the Common Core education standards. Trump regularly touts his full opposition.
We're going to terminate Common Core out of Washington. We're going to bring our education local.
Clinton doesn't talk Common Core much, but she does support it. Instead, her marquee education plan is about a different rung.
We came up with a plan that makes public college tuition-free for working families and debt-free for everyone.
Clinton's idea, inspired in part by former opponent Bernie Sanders, is threefold. One, she'd make in-state universities tuition-free for families earning less than $125,000. Two, community college would be tuition-free for everyone. And three, she'd address those who have to pay now.
If you already have debt, we will help you refinance it and pay it back as a percentage of your income so you're never on the hook for more than you can afford.
Clinton would raise taxes on the wealthy to pay for her college plan. The Green Party's Jill Stein would go further and erase all student debt with a kind of government bailout.
In contrast, Trump has no specific plan for college costs, though in a Twitter video, he did criticize the government's role in student lending. The candidates hit nearly opposite education issues, even as they fight for the same student and parent votes. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Lisa Desjardins.
Now, Jeffrey Brown looks more deeply into the differences between the two major nominees on education.
And for that, we turn to two journalists who cover this closely. Andrew Ujifusa is with our partners at Education Week. Scott Jasek is the editor of Inside Higher Education. Welcome to both of you.
Thank you.
Andrew, let me start with you. Let's start with K through 12 and these differences over vouchers and school choices. School choice, dramatic differences.
Yes, very dramatic differences. Recently, Donald Trump proposed a $20 billion federal school choice program, which a lot of conservatives like. It's not entirely clear how that would work in many instances, but it does have the backing of many Republicans. Clinton very much opposed to it. I think we should keep in mind here that the two national teachers unions, which very closely back Clinton and have for some time, they are very much opposed to vouchers as well.
Because they're historically worried about its implications for public education.
Yes, that's exactly right.
Is it clear how Donald Trump would pay for this?
No, he has not made that clear. He has not said, for example, where the money would come from within the federal government. I don't think he wants to raise taxes to pay for his school choice program. That would not go over well with fellow Republicans. But a lot of the details about that program are still unclear.
And with Hillary Clinton, she has expressed in the past some support for charter schools, right? But where is she? What is she saying these days?
That is a very good question. It is hard to say. I think in the past, it's fair to say she has been more supportive of charter schools. But ever since she hit the 2016 campaign trail, she has voiced more concerns about charter schools, such as the type of students they enroll. Again, that might reflect a lot of the concerns that teachers unions have about charters.
And then let me stay with you for the question of Common Core, because there again, you have Donald Trump, who's referred to it as a disaster, right?
Yes.
I think he's pretty clear.
Yes.
Hillary Clinton, measured support? Where would you put the two of them right now?
I think she does support the standards. She does not talk a lot about it. I think concerns with the Common Core on the Democratic side mostly have to do with tests that are connected to the Common Core. The unions have a lot of concerns about those tests and how they're used. Donald Trump has made it very clear he does not like the Common Core. That reflects in particular the position of the Republican base. He has not explained why he thinks it's a bad idea. He has said that he will get rid of the Common Core, but there's no real clear avenue for him to do that if he's elected.
Scott Jasek, where do you see, when you're looking at K through 12, the kind of school reform movement that we've watched over the many years now? Where do you see these two candidates generally?
I see the two candidates on school reform and actually a bit on higher ed reform in the same place. Barack Obama very much embraced school reform, innovation, online education, new ways of delivering education. Hillary Clinton, a little more skeptical, and I think that relates to her being close to the teachers unions, as we were talking about. Donald Trump, aside from a few speeches, has not given much detail at all.
So take us now more directly into the higher ed part, because here Hillary Clinton has taken a real strong position, right, with her idea for free public higher education for many.
Correct. She's proposing that everyone be entitled to free public tuition at public colleges in their home state, if you're from family incomes up to $125,000. That covers more than 80% of the population. She would give grants to states to distribute to the universities, which the states would have to match a $1 for three, so that there would be money to replace the lost tuition revenue.
And this one comes with a big price tag. I saw $500 billion.
It's a lot of money, and she has said that increased taxes on wealthier Americans would pay for it.
Now, what about Donald Trump? How much has he said? He has said less, I know, in this area.
He said very little. I've had two interviews with one of his top advisors who has described a desire to reform the student loan system to have banks and colleges mutually decide who is credit worthy. He has also opposed the free public tuition, public higher education tuition, and also opposed President Obama's free community college plan.
You were telling me just before we started something interesting, that a lot of people in the higher education community are focused on Donald Trump for what he said about immigration, even more than anything he said about specifically about education.
Right. He's gone through several iterations, but he says he wants to make it much more difficult for people to get a visa to come to the United States for a variety of purposes, including to study. This worries U.S. academic leaders who want and need foreign students.
So, Andrew, when you look at the education, you've been following this throughout the campaign, are you surprised by how much or how little attention it has gotten and in what forms it's gotten it?
I can't say I'm surprised. Education is never a top-tier issue, you know, in the election, and I think that's particularly true this go-around. I think that we should have expected that Donald Trump would bring up the Common Core because it is such a hot-button topic, particularly in the Republican base. It's also important to keep in mind that we have a new federal education law that President Obama signed at the end of last year. That sort of has taken education off the front burner for now in several ways.
This is the Every Student Succeeds, right, the act that picked up on the No Child Left Behind. So that was a big deal just a year ago.
It was a big deal. It remains to be a big deal. It returns a lot of the control over several key policy decisions to states and districts. So there's a little bit less for Washington to do, and states and other folks are still figuring out what exactly it means.
Scott, what do you see when you look broadly at the campaign and how much this has gotten?
I think we're going to hear more about Clinton's higher education plan. Her aides clearly see this as something that will reach middle-class voters. Many middle-class families are deeply concerned about paying for their children's college. And likewise, many people in academia worry about the future of public higher education, as states have in many ways walked away from their historic obligations.
And do you expect to hear more from Donald Trump as well?
I doubt we'll see her more from Donald Trump. One challenge he has is that when he talks about education, people talk about Trump University. And while that is not really typical of higher education, I don't think his aides view that as a positive topic of discussion.
All right. An issue to be continued in the campaign. Scott Jasek and Andrew Ujifusa, thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We've compiled the candidates' stances on education into a handy reference chart. You can find that on our website, pbs.org/newshour.
A new Ken Burns documentary airs tonight on PBS. And for this story, he co-directs with another filmmaker for whom the details are very personal. I talked with the two men at the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum about the cloak and dagger story behind Defying the Nazis, the Sharps War.
The telephone rang, and it was probably the most momentous telephone call that I ever received. Hello, wait still. I knew whose voice it was, the voice of my closest friend, Everett Baker. He said, wait still, Martha. I am inviting you to undertake the first intervention against evil by the denomination to be started immediately overseas.
And with that call in 1939, the life of Unitarian minister Waitstill Sharp and his wife Martha would never be the same, nor would the world. The Sharps, who lived in Wellesley, Massachusetts, were sent by their church to lead a secret and perilous rescue of refugees and dissidents in Europe before and after the start of World War II. They directly helped over 100 people escape and had a part in helping over 2,000 people avoid deportation to Nazi death camps. They expected to be gone for several months, and instead were gone 2 years.
They were motivated from the beginning to go out there into the kingdom of hell and try to get some people out.
They left two young children at home.
This story.
Artemus Jakowski is the grandson of the Sharps and son of the Martha Sharp, who was named after her courageous mother.
Artemus, this really has been almost a lifelong project for you since you were, what, in high school?
Yes, I was in ninth grade. And I was given an assignment to interview someone of moral courage. And I went home and I said to my mom, who should I interview? She said, talk to your grandmother. She did some cool things during World War II. And that interview changed my life.
What was it that she shared with you? I mean, obviously, you were young, she shared something with you that stayed.
Yes.
What was it?
I think a love for people, a love for difference, a love for celebrating what is good in the world and what makes the world so rich.
Ken, you have so many different film ideas to choose from. What was it about this story?
You know, this is a story that chose me. I did not start this project. It was started years and years ago by Artemus, and he brought it to me, and I looked at the germ of the story, and you know, I was so stunned that I had to drop everything. It's these two lone figures in the face of this gigantic tidal wave of the greatest cataclysm in human history, the Second World War. And what happens is that cataclysm becomes so big that it's undefinable. We say 6 million Jews, and we can't actually personalize it in a way. So here was an opportunity, a kind of back door, a stage door, to go through with these two extraordinary but improbable heroes, courageous people who are throwing us, the audience, into an espionage story, a spy story. I mean, this is a story of courage, but also of sacrifice.
In fact, the more he dug for documents, the more complicated and interesting the story became.
I didn't even know what I had. And then over the next 15 years, and working with Ken's team, we have now begun to create not just the story of what we're sharing with the world, but an archive that is all over the world. We have archives now in France, in Germany, in the Czech Republic that are connected to our collections. We've discovered over 200,000 documents that are now archived here at the museum. And what's extraordinary is how the documents come alive.
But you also lost a lot of documents because documents, thousands, millions of pages had to be burned.
Exactly.
To keep them from the Nazis.
Yeah. What is so remarkable about this project is how many people are coming forth today saying, the Sharps helped us in this way. We have documents that show the Sharps helped us. And this very large network of underground, rescuers, both the Jewish community, the Protestant community, the Catholic community, others who saw rescue as something that they had to do for their faith.
What he'd sent was this diamond in the rough, and you realize that the story was everything, and that you can always find a way to tell a story. If there's no pictures, then you find the documents. If there are no documents, then you find the pictures, or you get live cinematography, or you do something.
Dr. Otto Meyerhoff, a Jewish Nobel Prize-winning biochemist, who was hiding out in a small coastal village north of Cerbère.
To that end, some of those rescued are portrayed in the film through narration and photos. Leon Fischfanger, a German Jewish novelist and playwright, is one.
Why are you here doing what you are doing? I'm just as capable of the many sins of human nature as anyone else. But I believe that the will of God is to be interpreted by the liberty of the human spirit.
So I don't there are think interviews I with those who are still alive, like Rosemary Feigl of Vienna.
My father went from consulate to consulate trying to get visas to go anywhere that was plausible. That's how he met Martha Sharp, who saved my life. And my mother just packed my things. Martha gave us all beige berets, and there are pictures of us in those beige berets.
We realized that we were living in the front lines against Nazism. Wade still looked at me and, holding my hand tightly, whispered, courage.
Do you have a sense of what for her was the hardest, the scariest moment?
I think facing up to a Nazi official, knowing that this could be death. I think negotiating with people who she viewed in her mind as being not connected to human reality. I think she felt afraid for everyone she tried to help. I think that notion of this being just a drop in the bucket of how many people could have been saved, I think she lived with that pain and that regret all her life. Mm-hmm. That this story is not just about celebrating their lives, it's an instruction manual for how we need to operate today as people and as civilizations.
And at the same time, as Ken said, there was a personal toll.
Yes. Oh.
On your family, on your
yes.
mother. I mean, and there was some suggestion that project is an effort to do some healing.
Yeah.
How do you see that?
I think it's happened. I think my mother saw the film in the last month as we're getting ready to share this with the world, and she said, it's brilliant. And she understands how she felt as a child. We portray her in the film as a vulnerable child, just as the children my grandmother was rescuing.
It has something that is universal to it, and that's what I love. You see in acts, and particularly today, where we're wrestling in our own country with what direction we want to take. Do we wish to go this way, or do we wish to go that way? that these people open their hearts. He could give a sermon every Sunday. He could minister to the common problems of his parishioners. And then all of a sudden, he's in Nazi-occupied Prague, suddenly learning how to launder money. And she's trying to escape the Gestapo right. tail. And you suddenly realize, but this is all true. Okay. It is all true.
Towards the end, the film shows the Sharps' daughter, Martha Sharp Jakowski, aided by Rosemary Feigl, lighting the eternal flame at the Holocaust Remembrance Center, Yad Vashem. It was 10 years ago when the Sharps were honored as the righteous among the nations. They are two of only five Americans honored among 25,000 people with that distinction.
The documentary airs tonight on PBS stations. Check local listings. And Artemis Jakowski has just published a companion book about this story as well.
We close with an essay. Novelist Jeanine Capo-Cousette grew up in Miami and attended Cornell University in upstate New York. In addition to adjusting to the cold, Jeanine learned to navigate campus as a first-generation college student. Tonight, she shares thoughts on why colleges need to do better at welcoming students like her.
It took me going away to college to learn that by doing so, I'd become something called a first-generation college student. This means I was the first in my family to go to college, but it also meant I had no idea how much I didn't know. For instance, my family stuck around for all of freshman orientation because the paperwork about move-in day didn't explicitly state when they should leave. So we assumed they needed to be there the whole week. Long after other families had taken off, mine was still following me around as I registered for classes or during the school-mandated swim test. I was glad to have them there, but it did make for some awkward meals in the dining hall. Aside from going to class, I had no roadmap for what I was supposed to do as a newly minted college student. I navigated those first weeks by carefully watching what I thought of as real students, those whose parents had gone to college, who'd gotten a lifelong rundown of what was in store. That's how I knew to wear flip-flops in the shower or take notes in class, or that the visits to the writing center were covered by tuition. But there were still a lot I couldn't figure out this way. For instance, I dropped a class after realizing the textbooks would cost a couple $100s. By the time I learned that professors often put books on course reserve, it was too late to add it back that semester. Or like when my professor kept saying, "See me in office hours," as if we all knew what that meant. But it took a bad grade on a paper for him to explain to me what office hours were, that he was just waiting around in one place, ready to answer all my questions. What could my college have done to show me how much I needed to know without making me feel dumb or out of my league in the process? This is where well-meaning administrators usually start throwing around the word mentorship. But too many colleges still think of mentoring as just meetings between two people, one who knows some stuff and another who doesn't yet know that stuff. Technically, I had a mentor my first year in college, but when I finally met him, he didn't seem to understand how confused I was, in part because he came from a long line of college-going folks. He didn't know how much I didn't know either. Formal mentors, like the one my college assigned me, need to be first-generation college students themselves, or have been trained by people intimately familiar with the challenges students like me faced. They need to do more than send us concerned emails. They need to knock on our literal doors. And they should be compensated for their work as mentors, not asked to volunteer or serve out of some sense of obligation to help out a past version of themselves. They need to be concretely valued for the resource they are, for the unique survival skills they bring to campus. I now work as a novelist and, believe it or not, a professor. Whenever I'm in front of a group of new readers or students, I ask those who identify as first-generation college people to raise their hands. I then congratulate them. I tell them how much it means to me to meet them. And I tell them that I'm one of them. But later, after whatever talk or lecture I've given, there's almost always someone who comes up to me and admits they didn't raise their hand because they didn't know being a first-generation college student was a fact they could be proud of. Only then do I admit to them something I know that they don't. When I was in their place, I wouldn't have raised my hand either.
You can find more of our essays on our website at pbs.org/newshour/essays.
And a news update before we go. It is being reported tonight that federal prosecutors have filed terrorism charges against Ahmad Khan Rahami, the suspect in the New York and New Jersey bombings. They include use of a weapon of mass destruction and destruction of property. Rahami also faces charges of attempted murder for his shootout with police.
Tune in later tonight on Charlie Rose. Lead singer Bono of U2 joins Charlie as the band celebrates its 40th year. 40th year.
I believe.
I wouldn't know. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Gwen Ifill.
And I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again right here tomorrow evening for all of us at the PBS NewsHour. Thank you and good night.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by Lincoln Financial. Committed to helping you take charge of your financial future. BNSF Railway. XQ Institute. The Ford Foundation. Working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. Carnegie Corporation of New York. Supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at carnegie.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Election 2016 on PBS.